السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته الحمد لله الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستهديه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فهو المهتدي ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. Dear brothers and sisters, in the last few weeks we've been hearing about a story which happened in Pakistan, where a young lady with the name of Malala Yousafzai, 15 years of age, she was shot, and a couple of her friends who had minor injuries, but she had serious injuries. She was very close to death, and alhamdulillah, now she is recovering in Britain. Of course, with this tragic event, the media right away, they capitulate on it and cut and paste the way they like. Of course, the whole incident been tied up with Islamic group. So the damage there, and it happened. And it's unfortunate. Some part is fortunate that the whole people of Pakistan were angered and went in demonstration in supporting of Malala, which is good, thank God. None, as far as I know, of the Islamic institution abhorred this criminal act, and we find the media and the West take advantage of it. And for any simple person, when he read the news and so on, he immediately will connect the tragedy with that Islam is against education. As simple as that, especially education of girls and women. United Nations, and as you know, any time Islamic world would be attacked, it comes through women. Many conventions and so on, talking about the miserable situation of women. Big part of it is true, but not because of Islam. And this is where the connection is wrong. United Nations named November the 10th as a Malala Day. U.S. Secretary Hillary Clinton, on her blog, described her with the utmost bravery and so on. Gordon Brown, the British ex-prime minister, said, well, he is in a campaign with the title or motto of I am Malala. Even Hollywood did not spare the occasion not to jump on it and make big deal, or at least sing their songs. Angelina Jolie, which is, has a lot of goodwill efforts in the world and named by United Nations as a goodwill ambassador, opened a charity in the name of Malala. Even Madonna, who her feeling towards Islam not a secret, had Malala in one of her songs on the stages. Of course, who is the culprit? Anyone, if you say Taliban, we know Taliban, Pakistan, Taliban, Afghanistan, regardless, but why they always, when they say Taliban is Islamic group, here's where the problem. Is this kind of act is in Islam? Is it in the Quran? Is it in the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? or it has to do with cultures, has to do with primitive tribes, mountainous people, whatever tradition there. And my job here in the masjid is to explain what the Quran and what Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says about this subject. Women in Islam is very important part. It's a very important in the Quran. It's very important in the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It is very important in the seerah of the life of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And it's not a secret. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he used to gather strength in the time of difficulties and so on, he would cite his grandmothers. And he will exclaim or shout, holler highly, like in Hunayn, Ana ibn al-Fawatim, I am the son of, plural, of Fatima. And he has in his ancestry 13 of his grandmothers with the name Fatima. Other occasion, he would say, Ana ibn al-Awatiki min Sulaym. Awatiki has another 11 grandmothers with the name of Atika. Here's the Prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala getting strength, moral or spiritual strength, from mentioning the name of great women in his life or in his ancestry. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam movement or religion or whatever for any outside observer, let's say atheist or agnostic, he would study Islam, he cannot but to feel the importance of women in the life of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam from the time he was born till his death. We know there were very good, strong women around him. His mother, Amina bint Wahab, his nursing mother, Halima al-Sa'diyya, his babysitter and helper, who he called her my mother after my mother, which means after his biological mother, Baraka bint Thalaba al-Habashiyya. Also Fatima bint Asad, the wife of Abu Talib, was in the role of his mother. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, role of Khadija in his life, nobody can deny it. She's a strong, educated, wealthy woman, very wise. He lived with her all her the rest of her life, 25 years, till she died at age 65, and he continued to mention her every day till he died. And he described his love to her as a gift from God. Inni ruziqtu hubbaha. Khadija radiallahu anha gave him the birth to four beautiful girls: Zainab, Ruqayya, Umm Kulthum, and Fatima radiallahu anhum ajma'een. A man grew up in this, cannot put down women, because all of them were so great, so good to him, and so like lights in his life, and so on. And we know the rest of the wives of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, like Umm Salama, was a very strong, willed woman, very wise, and had a lot of participation in the events of Islam, like in Sulh al-Hudaybiyah. We know Aisha radiallahu anha, she taught us everything inside the house of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And she was teaching everyone comes, of course. She has relatives from her sister Asmaa, who were very close entering because they are muhram, but she taught many, many of the Sahaba. And she lived around 50 years after the death of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, till she died in the year 57 of the Hijrah. And she was a school by herself. We know over 1,210 ahadith narrated by Aisha radiallahu anha. Hafsa, the daughter of Umar radiallahu anhum ajma'in, She was the school of teaching the Quran. It's no wonder that the first copy of the Quran was entrusted not to a man, whoever, and there were plenty of great men who would sacrifice their lives for preserving or protecting the Quran, the first copy of the Mus'haf was at the house of Hafsa, radiallahu anha. And from Hafsa, Uthman took the copy and copied them into multiple copies and so on. And Ramla bint Abi Sufyan, see that picture, Abu Sufyan, the great of Quraysh and many wars, he was the leader like Uhud and Khandaq. He comes because of his daughter, Ramla, Ummu Habiba, to the house, to the bedroom of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And here's Ramla has a fight and the debate with her father, who is the great leader of Quraysh. And she put him down. And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam quiet, sitting there, and Ramla taking care of her dad and soften his heart to the truth. And we know that has big effect in Fatah Mecca and so on. Islam believes strongly that women are the makers of men. And I might be wrong, and everything I say wrong here, it's of my own shortcoming and ignorance. And if I say something right, it's from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the understanding of the Quran and the Sunnah of His Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I see the failure of the Muslims nowadays is due to the failure of the women in Islam, in the Muslim world. It's like in the 60s, 70s. You remember the cars industry suffered major losses. They lost to the Japanese and the German cars. And I'm not talking about World War II. Happened in Japan and Germany were against the rest of the world and the United States. Why? Because they analyzed and studied the situation because the assembly lines were outdated. They are not educated. They are not up to the task. They cannot produce medium and small size cars. While the Japanese and the Germans were able to upgrade and change all their outmoded assembly lines and put robots and so on, and that's how they produced beautiful cars. The same thing, women. If they are not educated, up to date, and so on, they cannot produce moral children. And I'm not talking education here about becoming a secretary or to become a seller at one of the chain store, etc. Nothing wrong with any kind of decent work. But here I mean education in the halal and haram, education in the Quran and the Sunnah, education of teaching akhlaq and moral values to raise solid children. This is a major failure for us Muslims nowadays, even in this age of education all over the Muslim world and the rest of the world. I mean, it's no secret. I am not everywhere, even Saudi Arabia. They have a lot of education and schools for women and men, girls and boys, etc. But it's unfortunate the act of very few people make this bad impression and effect on Islam. The woman in Islam goes beyond that to the companions of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And I haven't seen in history of mankind any great man, any prophet, any king, any philosopher, any great person of history has so many followers whose life been documented and been talking about like the women in Islam. In our series, which I'm following, or at least taking some stories from, is Usud al-Ghaba. This is volume 7. The whole volume is dedicated to the biography of over 1,100 women and their achievements in Islam. you name it, from education to teaching Quran to teaching Hadith and so on, not to mention their participation in all the events of the Muslim from Al-Aqaba al-Thaniya all the way till the death of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. All of us, we hear about Ummu Umara, Nusayba bint Ka'b al-Maziniya al-Najjariya, Ummu Sulaym bint Malhan, and Ummu Haram, and Khawla bint Thalaba. Most of those Sahaba, there is Quran revealed on their behalf. And we need to know which ayat been revealed. You remember Khawla, how, you know, Umar ibn al-Khattab was talking to her, and somebody told, you talk to this old woman, he told them, why not? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam listened to her, and Allah from seventh heaven listened to her. Rubaya bint al-Mu'awad, and Umm Kulthum bint Uqba, and Atika bint Zayd bin Amr bin Nufail. And beyond the Sahaba age, the Tabi'een, Tabi'at Tabi'een. We mentioned when we talked about the great four Imams, the role of the women in their lives. We have talked about the mother of Imam Shafi'i. She made him. The mother of Imam Malik, she made him. The mother of Rabi'atul Ray, she made him. Of course, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is destined to, but it happened through those women. Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, the role of his mother in his life is amazing. Even out of his appreciation, and that's his own decision, he did not get married till his mother died because he was afraid of whatever can happen between the wife and mother-in-law and so on might hurt her. And that tradition went on and on for education of women. I don't know in history any time that has been stopped. And I don't mean learning alphabet or basic knowledge. I mean all of them become what, if you want to translate, like we translate currency to nowadays currency, they earn PhD degrees. And let me mention some of the names. And there's books written about them. Siyar A'lam al-Nisa, and many other books. Let me just, for the sake of, you know, those names, let them touch our ears. Maybe one day we can study them. Zumurrud Khatun, who died in the year 557. She was a princess in the knowledge of the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and in propagating this hadith by copying copies of it and the teaching of the Quran, also in building masajid. Imam Hafiz al-Mundhiri, he's a great scholar. It happened, I read his book, Targhib wa Tarhib lil-Hafiz al-Mundhiri, when I was young. It's a scary book because he was really very stern. Al-Hafiz al-Mundhiri, he tells us he got his knowledge from 20 of female scholars in Cairo, Alexandria, Damascus, Baghdad, Asbahan, Naysabur, Hamadan, and Harran. And he mentions that those 20, he is in debt in his knowledge to these women. And I will quickly narrate those. Safa'ul Aish, Abdullah al-Ashrafiyya, Khadija bint al-Hafiz, Abi al-Tahir, Karima Abdul Wahhab, Ali al-Asadiyya, Lami'a Abi Bakr al-Mubarak, Aid al-Shams, Ahmed al-Thaqafi, Zahra, Abdul Qadir al-Rahfawi. All of them died in the 5th century, and those were teachers of Al-Imam Al-Hafiz Al-Mundhiri. Those are PhD scholars, not ordinary teachers. Whom do you want more strict than Imam Ibn Taymiyyah and Imam Ibn Al-Qayyim Al-Jawziyyah? Let's see what Imam Ibn Qayyim Al-Jawziyyah says. He said that he studied most, or he earned most of his knowledge from women. He studied in Damascus, the hadith on Sitt al-Kataba Ni'ma Ali al-Tarrah. In Cairo, he studied under Abdul Karim Fatima Sa'd al-Ansari. In Alexandria, he studied under Khadija Ahmad Muhammad al-Asbahani. In Baghdad, he studied under Farha al-Auni and Atika al-Hamadaniya and Abdul Rahman Yahya Ali al-Baghdadi and Hafsa Ahmad al-Azijiyya. And in Asbahan, he studied under Afifa Ahmad al-Farfaniya. And in Naysabur, he studied under Zainab Abdul Rahman al-Naysaburi. And in Hamadan, Fatima al-Hasan al-Hamadani. And who is Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziya? One of the lightning rods in the history of Islamic knowledge. He had over 12 of his teachers were women, PhDs, in the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They know the halal and the haram, and they know the moral values and so on. And as mothers, they produced good quality children. Another lady who lived in the 6th and 7th century, Karima Bint Abdul Wahhab al-Dimashqiyya. Her title was Musnidatu Sham, Musnidatu Sham. Her student is Al-Hafiz ibn al-Sabuni, who died in the year 680. And he said, I have listened to her a lot, and I have took from her a lot of knowledge. And she was of the righteous woman, the knowledgeable woman. When she mentioned the name of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, she would holler his name in a loud voice in the masjid, and her tears come down her cheeks. And Imam al-Hafiz al-Zahabi said, الشيخ الصالح المعمرة مسندة الشام كانت لا تمل من الرواية. She never stopped of teaching the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And another lady with the name Sitt al-Arab bint Yahya al-Kindiya. And guess who is her brilliant student? None but Imam Ibn Taymiyyah al-Harrani, one of the most important teachers who taught him, Ibn Taymiyyah, the teacher of Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyya, was Sitt al-Arab bint Yahya al-Kindiya. And also she was the teacher of Al-Imam al-Dhahabi. These are female teachers who had degree nowadays probably equal to PhD in the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And she died in the year 684. Fatima bint Sulaiman al-Ansariya. This lady also was a teacher with hundreds of students come to listen to her and take ijazah, take a certificate of the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Imam al-Hafiz al-Zahabi has mentioned her in the book Ad-Durr al-Manthur fi Tabaqat Rabbat al-Khudur. He has a book about the ladies who taught and excelled in knowledge, and that she had a lot of awqaf for students and for charity and so on. She died in the year 708 of Hijrah. Zainab bint Yahya ibn al-Izz ibn Abd al-Salam. Of her students, Al-Hafiz al-Zahabi also. And he had a lot of praise to her. She died in the year 735. Another muhaditha with the name Aisha bint Muhammad. She was a teacher of the hadith in Masjid al-Nabawi. In Masjid Bani Umayyah in Dimashq, in Damascus. And Ibn Battuta, who we know he's a great traveler, who visited the whole known world and had this in a book, he said in the year 726, he was in Damascus and he was in the masjid, and he has seen Aisha bint Muhammad teaching in the masjid of Bani Umayyah in Damascus. And she would not make money out of her teaching. She had a job of knitting clothes, and she would sell those knitted clothes to live out of it. And she lived 90 years, and she died in the year 736. Zainab bint Ahmed al-Maqdisiyya al-Dimashqiyya. She had a halaqa in Masjid Bani Umayyah in Damascus, and she had thousands of students, men and women, who came to learn, and Imam al-Zahabi had described her in details and called her Musnidat al-Sham. And when she died, Imam Ibn Hajar said the level of education dropped one step when this lady died. She died in the year 740. Also, Sitt al-Arab al-Maqdisiyya, who her brilliant student was Abu Zara al-Iraqi. He was one of the great Hafiz. His teacher was Sitt al-Arab al-Maqdisiyya. And she died in the year 767. And Fatima bint Muhammad al-Tanukhiyya, her student is Ibn Hajar, the author of Tafsir Sahih al-Bukhari, Fath al-Bari fi Sahih al-Bukhari, one great monumental work. If he had many publications, but if he had only this, it's enough for him. This giant was a student of Fatima al-Tanukhiyya, and he tell us that I have studied under her 149 books. Where is the situation of women came to us from? I don't know. Islam promotes education for men and women. Islam promotes the teacher. We know the hadith that if you raise a child, girl child, and teach her and prepare her to face life and so on, you will be in heaven. There is no ayah in the Quran. There is no hadith in the book of the six sahih books and so on, which tells you not to educate women or deprive them from learning and knowing the basics and knowing the fiqh and knowing the hadith and knowing the Quran and knowing other things like professions and so on. All of this inheritance came to us from the ages of ignorance and the ages of darkness, supported by locality of inferior cultures here and there, and unfortunately transmitted to us as a deen. And it is not a deen. And we are suffering now. We have attacks. Because here now, you know, education of women, you like it or not, is widespread all over the globe. And it's coming, unfortunately, through secularism, through governments, through pressures from East and West and so on. And the bottom line, you look everywhere in the world, there is education of women. So why we have few people who give the image that Islam is against education, especially of women? There is no support for that claim from the Quran al-Kareem or the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I know the relation between men and women outside even education, as far as life, we know how it is as described in the Quran and as described by the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the main part of it is lowering the gaze and having a crystal clear heart, and not to intermingle unnecessary outside the society, and never to be alone with somebody who is not a muhram. Because disaster can happen. And every day we hear on TV and the news how big figures, how they are falling from their position because of this khalwa, because of being alone with a lady who is not a muhram. Because this attraction between men, and it's like the magnet. You cannot help it. If you put two magnets, the north will attract the south pole or part of the magnet. You like it or not. So the only way to prevent them of sticking together outside the marriage is to keep them apart. At any rate, I will stick to our subject, which is saying some stories or some incidents from the lives of the companions of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. As we have said, there is no page in the seerah. You don't find a woman in the life of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If she is a mother, if she is an aunt, if she is a wife or a sister, a daughter, and of his companions. Usud al-Ghaba, he described to us 1,100 ladies, companions of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And today's our companion, not one of the major ones we know of those names I mentioned, but she is very important. And has over 81 hadith she narrated. And she had an incident happened we need to mention. And she died in the year 30 of the Hijrah. And her name is Asmaa Bint Yzed Ibn al-Sakan al-Ashhaliyya al-Ansariyya. She is a cousin of Mu'adh ibn Jabal, radiallahu anhu. And you know who is Mu'adh ibn Jabal. He's a great towering figure in knowledge of the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Quran and the fiqh. Asma al-Ashhaliyya came in to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he was among his companions. فقالت بأبي وأمي أنت يا رسول الله. This is a way to start a talk. She is preferring him over her parents, out of her praise and love to the Prophet of Allah, the Messenger of Allah. So she told him, بأبي وأمي أنت يا رسول الله. أنا وافدة النساء إليك. I am the representative of the women to you. And she told him, صلى الله عليه وسلم, إن الله عز وجل بعثك إلى الرجال والنساء كافة. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent you as a messenger to men and women, or to all men and women. إلى النساء والرجال كافة. فآمنا بك وبإلهك. We have believed in you as a messenger of God and in your God, the creator of heaven and earth. وَإِنَّا مَعْشَرَ النِّسَاءِ مَحْصُورَاتٌ مَقْصُورَاتٌ قَوَاعِدُ بُيُوتِكُمْ وَمَفْضَى شَهَوَاتِكُمْ وَحَامِلَاتِ أَوْلَادِكُمْ. And we are women, we are wives of you men. We are doing the homework, we are becoming pregnant, we deliver the babies, and we take care and raise those babies. وَإِنَّكُمْ مَعْشَرَ الرِّجَالِ فُضِّلْتُمْ عَلَيْنَا بِالْجُمَعِ وَالْجَمَاعَاتِ. And you men, you have an advantage over us from her own, perspective. She has seen that women has men has an advantage of attending the Jumu'ah, the Friday prayers, and Jama'at, the congregational prayers. وعيادة المرضى, and visiting the sick. وشهود الجنائز, and attending the funerals. والحج بعد الحج, and going to Hajj after Hajj. And a jihad في سبيل الله, and participating in the jihad. And when the man leaves for any of these functions, حفظنا لكم أموالكم, we protect your wealth, your homes, and your belongings. And we raise your kids. أفما نشارككم في هذا الأجر والخير, isn't there any reward for us for doing that? فالتفت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إلى أصحابه بوجهه كله. So the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم turned towards his companions in whole body and out of importance and respect, and he said, هل سمعتم مقالة امرأة قط أحسن من مساءلتها في أمر دينها من هذه؟ He was amazed about the eloquence of this woman in her expressing herself and being very precise in mentioning what the problem is. So he told the companions, have you ever heard any better way of asking questions in the issues of deen of this woman? The companions answered, فقالوا يا رسول الله ما ظننا أن امرأة تهتدي إلى مثل هذا. We never thought a woman can express herself this way. Then the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم turned back to the woman and told her, فالتفت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إليها فقال افهمي أيتها المرأة وأعلمي من خلفك من النساء أن حسن تبعل المرأة لزوجها وطلبها مرضاته واتباعها موافقته يعادل ذلك كله فانصرفت المرأة وهي تهلل. So here the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, everything you mentioned, this is paraphrasing or putting it the essence of what he answered her, that everything you mentioned of what the woman thought it's an advantage for men over women of attending the Jum'ah and Jama'at and the funerals and Iyadat al-Mareed and Jihad and all of this, the woman thought this is an advantage for her. It will make the men above the women in the reward. All of this equal to the good companionship. This is the meaning of taba'ul, said husnu musahabatiha lahu, the good companionship to your husband. And here the woman left very happy, and he told her to tell the woman behind you. Didn't she tell him that I am the representative of the woman? So he told you, tell your fellow women what I told you. And فانصرفت المرأة وهي تهلل. What we learn from this, that in Islam, men and women are equal. And this equality is much deeper what the word equality means, and nowadays we use it. Though anatomically and physiologically, they are completely different. Males are not like females in many, many aspects. And they are weaker, they are smaller, and they have special talents in many subjects. The men has different talent and so on. But equality here goes beyond what we know about equality here nowadays, and we talk about it too much. And that is the equality in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We know that they are asked to do the same thing as men, and they have an advantage. In many occasions, they are not supposed to do what men do, like prayers during periods. The women, they don't have to do that, and many other issues. As far as the reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's equal. Inna al-mu'minina wal-mu'minat wal-muslimina wal-muslimat. A long ayah describes men and women that they have the same reward in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is the ultimate equality. And also this equality in life. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us that women are the twins of men. Ar-rijalu shaqa'iqun nisa. And who is closer to who more than twins? So the man and woman, as far as value, as far as worth, they are equal. But when it comes to the functions, they are different. We come to the issue of the relation perpendicular, not horizontal. The Quran, and this is, I never seen it in any other place or religion, that he emphasized on the woman to be your mother and to your aunt and sister and daughter. And tell me anyone who will show the male chauvinism over his mother or daughter or sister. بَعْضُكُمْ مِنْ بَعْضٍ. And this inject the love and compassion among the Muslims. We don't have this animosity which is created, you know, in the material world between men and women. Now we come to the issue of women themselves as wives. And here where the problem, and unfortunately in the Middle Ages, we inherited a lot of negative things about women comes to us from different culture, different religions, and not supported by any ayah in the Quran or any hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Here as wives, this is very special relation. You know, all life is so complex, and also the relation between men and women as husband and wife is very complex. And nowadays, we think with this equality between men and women, we achieved a lot. The woman is a failure, is a loser in this situation nowadays. Nobody interested in marrying anymore. Nobody trusts any man anymore. The man is foxy and smart. He outsmarted the woman. He gets everything from the woman. You cannot get it in the Muslim environment but through marriage. Free, without any efforts, without anything. He changes women as long as they pass their prime. And the average, according to Hite report and Johnson report of sexuality in the West, that every man changed 13 women in his life, in his lifetime. And the poor woman suffers all along. And not to mention homosexuality, not to mention living in without any relation, like, and the laws try one after one to be fair to the woman, but they are losers on the long run. In Islam, there is an ideal solution. The essence of marriage in Islam, if you go to the books of fiqh, beyond the love, the compassion, the being need each other as far as instinct, as far as biology, as far as fitra, the way we're built, you feel comfort and peace and so on, home. All of this has been described in the Quran and the Hadith, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But when you go to the fuqaha and they tell you, they remove all these things, they peel it off to go to the essence and the crux of the marriage contract between men and women. And they tell you it is akin to uqood al-ajar. It is like the man is leasing the woman female organs and female secondary characteristics in the marriage contract. So he would support her and support financially, material-wise, and so on for life, and she will be exclusively for him to produce babies eventually. There's many other benefits, but this is the essence. And this is what we call عقد النكاح. Why we use the word nikah? I don't know in English if they use marriage. عقد النكاح, which is in its essence, it is one of عقود, very similar. I went to the fiqh in the madhahib al-arba'ah, and I found that all of them, they say very close to عقد الأجار, or like the lease contract. That's why I don't think homosexual can achieve that part if they want marriage or عقد نكاح. I mean, they don't have the uterus and the ovaries and so on, so they cannot fulfill that. Their gathering, they can find another name for it, but not marriage or عقد نكاح. And based on that, the scholars in the fourth school of thought, they varied in what's the responsibility and duties of men and women in the contract. You find in Fiqh Abu Hanifa, and this is probably the most logical thing based on many incidents in the Hadith and the Seerah of the Sahaba and so on, that the woman is beside this specific job or description for procreation and so on, that she is assigned to home jobs, from taking care of the house, she is the master of the house, she is the lordess of the house, cooking, taking care of kids, and so on. And the man is outside work to make money and to bring bread and food at the end of the day to the house. But of course, not all scholars agree on that. As you, if you go to Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, says no, she doesn't have to do all of this. You know, the contract is very clear for procreation and for satisfying the needs and the sexual desires and so on, for both, and especially for procreation. So if the woman wants, you know, not to cook, that's fine. Imam Malik, the same thing. She's not assigned to do the cooking or taking care of the house and so on. The husband has to bring her help. Of course, in Imam Abu Hanifa, may Allah be for rahimahullah, forgive him, has assigned the issue of you can put clauses in the marriage contract that she doesn't want to leave her country or doesn't want to leave her city, or there is many clauses which are legitimate, and she can request all of this. Who would teach those young girls their rights in the marriage, regardless of the wide spectrum of the fuqaha, what they have said about that? It's in the interest of the male, who is chauvinist usually, and become a tyrant at home. And it's so easy to become a tyrant at the level of the family or society or the country. Many specialists, physiologists, psychiatrists have studied, psychologists, the issue of evil and how those tyrants happen. Is it once in 100 years you can have one Hitler or Stalin or something? No, any one of us can become tyrant in the right environment. And many, many husbands in our world they are inside their homes, tyrants, and worse than Hitler and worse than Stalin in abusing their wives. Because the environment at home with the security or the privacy of home, anything can be done onto those weak creatures. And this is not only in the Muslim world, all over the world. The battered woman is a well-known phrase. You know, we know all of us what it means. So it's very easy for husband to abuse the wives. And it happens. And it happens as an epidemic. And one of the solutions for us to teach the women what Islam teaches about their jobs, their responsibilities, their duties. And I don't mind any fiqh school of thought, but let her know what's her rights, what she's supposed to do and not to do. And education is the best weapon in the hand of everyone, anyone, at any aspect of life. One time when Tocqueville was in the United States and he wrote a beautiful book about democracy in America, and he asked one influential person, I mean, are those Indian, the Native American, he called them the savage nobles, and the African slaves, are why they are like this? And he told them, no, they are human like us, and we are the same, but the difference is education. Don't deprive anyone of education. This is the only way for us nowadays, if you want to have a better life, better means, better future, educate at any level. Educate your wife, educate your children, males and females. This is the wings for them to soar and fly. Without education, we'll fall down and we will be eliminated. We're finished. So please, brothers and sisters, let us continue to educate ourselves and learn till the end of our lives. No wonder the first two verses in the Quran came about reading and writing. The first word in the Quran, Iqra, the second, Noon wal qalami wa ma yasturun, read and write. So may Allah bless you all. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.